So, Yönten is going to lead the motivation this morning.
I would read the phrase 22 in English and in Hebrew. Whatever appears in your own mind, your mind from the start was free from fabricated extremes. Understanding this, do not take to mind inherent signs of subject and object. This is the practice of bodhisattvas. And in Hebrew, it is Kol ha'ofaot en todatcha shelcha atzmicha. התודעה מטבעה מתעלה מעבר לכל ההרחבות המנטליות. לדעת זאת ולהישאר חופשי משוויים של סובייקט ואובייקט, זהו התרגול של ילדי הבודה. And I found in the Dalai Lama commentary something that he wrote about this phrase that I thought was interesting and I would read it also. He quotes in his commentary about this phrase, it says, I, the truly non-existent practitioner of space-like emptiness, see that in reality, nothing exists intrinsically. All visual and auditory appearances are revealed as illusory pictures. And from this union of delightful appearance and emptiness, I have become convinced incontrovertibly of dependent arising.
It's really good if we can make friends with these verses so that we can kind of pick out a favorite or a favorite for that day or month or year to orient the rest of the day with. I think it can really pull a lot of meaning into the rest of the day and also not make it the path too overwhelming. You know, if you just zero in on one part, everything else is implied. Right? Everything else is implied, but sometimes you want to emphasize the ultimate, sometimes you want to emphasize the relative, but either way, the other one is in the background. Mm-hmm. So if we can just keep reading through these, I think that they get richer and richer over time, and there's some that right away spark your interest, and then there's some that you come to become friends with over time. So anyway, appreciate you guys taking turns leading the motivation. I really appreciate it. I think it's a nice way to make friends. Yeah. Okay, so the verse that we're up to in terms of the discussion on bodhicitta is verse 12. So here's where we're moving into the section of the outline, the post-meditation practice of using unfavorable conditions on the path. And using on the path the four things you don't want to happen. The four things you don't want to happen are loss, suffering, disgrace, and disparagement. You know, so classic human issues, it's using them as the tools for transformation. So up until this point, we were having preliminaries, and then we were like illuminating or shining a light on the main point of the practice, bodhicitta. And now it's saying, now that you're on board with the whole concept of bodhicitta, what do you do during a day? How do you use everything that happens on the path? So this verse 12 is how to use loss. And it says, even if someone out of strong desire steals all your wealth or has it stolen, dedicate to him your body, possessions, and your virtue, past, present, and future. This is the practice of bodhisattvas. So this is the practice of, with a background understanding of karma and with a forefront holding of exchanging self for others. So there's exchanging self for others in meditation, whether you go through that analytical process or you do Tonglen. But when you're actually in your everyday life, exchanging self for others boils down to these kind of practices where if someone steals from you, for example, they steal your partner, they steal your possessions, they steal your position, they steal something, right? That instead of blaming them or becoming angry at them, you say, sure, it's yours, mentally. Physically, you might still have to take people to court, right? Physically, you might still need to have an assertive conversation, but it's never with retaliation, right? So now when people are taking things from us, we no longer want the response of how do I get them back or how do I punish them? Because that's not the practice of a bodhisattva. The bodhisattva wants the person to stop doing that. They want the person to stop taking, but it's because of their own practice. They know that if they continue to take in this way, they accumulate huge amounts of negative karma that's going to ripen as deprivation and suffering in the future. So they don't want them to take, but it's not from a self-centered idea. So then when others do take, you from your side realize that this is the karmic ripening of your own past. And what's more, if you deal with it well, it finishes. They're doing you a favor in a way, right? Oh, that one's done. I didn't have to purify it. It ripened, it finished, now it's done. And that if you hadn't created the cause, they might still have the habit, but it wouldn't have happened with you and them. Yeah, so they might still be a thief of some kind, but you wouldn't have been the one that they took from. If you hadn't created the cause specifically, it would have happened to someone else. So then the bodhisattva can even be happy and think, well, thank goodness they took from me and not someone else who's really going to suffer because of this. I'm so glad they stole from me. Because I've found a spiritual path and I have a Sangha community and I have teachers and thank goodness I can take this on the path. If they had stolen from someone else, that someone else might have reacted with anger and had more negative karma, et cetera, et cetera. So when we're approaching loss, we're trying to shift into this broader view that really exchanges our own ideas about comfort and happiness for their comfort and happiness. And we dedicate for them thinking, this thing that you stole, I give you freely. So now it's not stealing anymore. You haven't stolen because I gave it to you. And it said that Gelsuk Tome Zangpo, who composed this text, had this happen to him where he was on the road with his possessions on teaching tour, and a band of robbers stole all of his possessions. And instead of retaliating or becoming upset with them, he was very calm and he said to the thieves, oh, can you hang on just 1 minute? And the thieves were so surprised at how calm he was, they stopped and they were like, what? And he said to them, I need to dedicate all of this for you. So just give me a minute, I need to dedicate. So he did his prayer. And then he said, the road that you're on will go by one of my benefactors and they will see the possessions that you've taken and you'll get in trouble. So it's better if you take another road so the benefactor doesn't see you having stolen my possessions and you get in trouble. So take this safer route. You know, so this is an example of just really incredible bodhisattva practice. And it's not like magically he got his possessions back. It's not like magically the thieves stopped being thieves, but it was no longer such a karmically fraught situation for either side. So it's a confronting practice, but I think that just by thinking of it in a few minutes, we can touch the power of it and how different life is. If whenever we felt someone was taking advantage, if we shifted to thinking, I offered it anyway. If we're aspiring to be bodhisattvas, we're offering our body, speech, mind, possessions, roots of virtue, etc., etc., because we also have the background understanding of dependent arising, that anything we own is through the work and experiences and collaboration with others. Nothing is self-created. Is it really ours anyway? So it's really looking around all these different edges of how we experience loss and realizing that there's actually many ways to see loss as a good thing. And even to see poverty as a good thing, because you're going to be less targeted by people who have negative dispositions if no one thinks you have anything. So there's a lot of different angles, right? There's a lot of different angles, and you could see how this could be misunderstood very easily, and someone could be like, yes, take everything, and they could be excessively charitable, so much so that they're no longer able to look after their own basic needs. And this isn't the teaching, right? The teaching is about a mental attitude. And then what you physically do has to be practical. Because if you give away everything and are in complete deprivation, now other people have to look after you anyway. So it's not really bodhisattva work. It's a bit like saying, I'll be the brave one and go out to the supermarket and go to see all these different people. I'll be the brave one, when in fact, you might be bringing sickness home to your family, or you might be actually making yourself sick. And then who are you going to benefit? If you get sick, then people have to look after you. If you're well, you can look after them. You know, so we can get this kind of short-sightedness that says, I'll be the brave one that goes and does this kind of heroic thing, giving away my body, giving away my possessions. But it's so short-lived, and then you wind up being a burden on others. So it's not a short-sighted teaching. It's really having this breadth of understanding past and future lives, the whole expanse of this life, and how the way we approach possessions needs to shift, but what we actually do with our positions has to be practical. It's a straightforward kind of a verse. It's hard to practice, but I think it's easy enough to understand. Do you have thoughts about that or questions?
It's like not a poem, but there is Les Miserables, you know, this
the play, yeah.
Play, and there is one figure who he's a pamutim. I don't know how it's called. They stole from him.
Yeah.
He was like a bodhisattva because he said it's a gift for me, something like this. So it reminds me.
Yeah, exactly that. That's my favorite part. That's my favorite part of the whole play. Yeah, exactly. And that's exactly the bodhisattva response. It is. And, you know, I see this with my teacher sometimes. It's not like he's encouraging theft or something. But when you come to his house, he's immediately like, what can I give you? You know, and like, you know, he's just like, here, what can I give you? What can I give you? Immediately, just he's so happy to have an opportunity to give. Someone's in my house, cup of tea, obviously. Now biscuit. Now, Yönten, do you have enough socks? And I'm like, yeah, I have enough socks, Rinpoche. And he's like, do you have enough t-shirts? I have some t-shirts for sleep, I'll give you. You know, sometimes he gives unnecessarily and all the nuns are like, why has he given us all Tibetan sun hats made from chopsticks? But it's really sweet. I should send you a picture. They're like, they look like duck bills, and they're made out of like four chopsticks going straight out like a visor. And he brought all of the nuns home, each one of these hats from Tibet once. But you could tell that he was really like, what can I bring back to my community? What can I bring back? You know, just always thinking of others. You know, if he's in a line at a cafe and there's people really close to him, he's forever buying their coffee. You know, it's a really interesting thing to see how joyful he is to give things away. It's a joy for him. It's not a wrench, and he doesn't need appreciation. Like in the case of the ridiculous hats, no one was going to be wearing these in Australia. He didn't care. He was just happy to have thought of us and to, you know, have brought a gift back for us. And we were happy to receive them and probably all still have them in our drawer somewhere. But, you know, it's like the possessions aren't the point. The possessions aren't the point. It's all about the mentality you bring to it. So I think holding this one in the heart, it can be really helpful when you're stressed, because when you're stressed, you have the tendency to hoard and cling to and get miserly. That's the tendency when you're stressed, because it feels like protection. Feels like protection, when in fact it kind of keeps you trapped and it makes you feel deprived, right? It triggers deprivation mentality. And when you have deprivation mentality, nothing is ever going to feel like enough. When you have that kind of gratitude mentality, you know, really small amounts feel like a huge abundance. When I was first ordained, I lived in an A-frame, you know, these like little like triangle houses that are so small that if you put your arms out, you can touch both walls. It was this tiny little A-frame. And I loved it so much, but they put me there because I was like the baby junior nun. And once you've been there a year, then you get an upgrade. And I remember moving from this tiny A-frame to a tiny room in a house that had a bathroom in the house. It was so exciting. Never mind that like 2 years before I had my own house. I had a whole house with my own bathroom I could use anytime, you know, but because I had sort of let go of some of my neediness about space and possessions, moving from a tiny room with no bathroom to moving to a tiny room where there was a shared bathroom felt like luxury. You know, and it shows us what our minds do if we let them get flexible like this. Yeah. Yeah, other thoughts about this verse 12? So we'll just look at the page 18 outline one last time for this round and just check in about joyous effort. On Monday, we talked about connecting with contentment, the supports for joyous effort, the four forces, and the power of aspiration, this yearning and building energy before we start. Then the power of steadfastness, which was with these three types of confidence. And then the power of joy, being insatiable about the spiritual path and positive work. And then the power of relinquishment, knowing when and how to rest. So now that you've had some time for them to sit, did you have thoughts come up about them? This whole framework of, you know, the beginning is types of joyous effort, then obstacles to joyous effort, and then supports for joyous effort. I mean, it's very logical. It's easier said than done, but I think it's very tidy, clear, elegant sort of framework to realize where energy is taken and where energy is given. I guess if we're looking at this whole framework, we just have to remember that for joyous effort to be a perfection of joyous effort, it always needs bodhicitta. And it also needs all the other perfections inside of it, right? So you need the generosity of joyous effort and the ethics of joyous effort and the patience of joyous effort and the joyous effort of joyous effort and the concentration of joyous effort and the wisdom of joyous effort. And when those all are kind of together implicitly and with bodhicitta, then it's getting into a real perfection. But even, you know, a more superficial version of these can be very powerful. But so kind of thinking about where our joyous effort's at right now, and then how can we upgrade? Yeah, how can we upgrade? Not because we should or it's best or something, but because it will be more effective and our life will be more joyful. Because we're all lucky enough to have meaningful work, right? We're all really incredibly fortunate that we have meaningful work. And so we don't have to like wait till we get home from work in order to have a meaningful life. Work is meaningful, pre-work is meaningful, study is meaningful, family life is meaningful. You know, really all the details for a very rich life are available to all of us. And it's an amazing thing, but we could kind of take them for granted, you know, and just kind of like do the everyday version of meaningfulness, you know, like I'll get the job done, tick, tick, tick. Glad I did a good day. Or we could have a kind of more expansive attitude about the exact same day. You know, you don't have to change what you're doing in a day. It's just kind of elevating the motivation because that's going to build a real strength with continuity over time. And it makes the whole process a lot more joyful. And it means when hardships arise, they're all within a framework that's really workable. So just remembering those things that you really know already, but that self-cherishing makes things narrow. Bodhicitta makes things expansive. Self-cherishing makes things tight and suffocated. Cherishing others makes things spacious and flexible. Yeah. So whenever you're thinking about work, if you get into good work, but with self-cherishing, you're going to burn out. Yeah. If you're doing very excellent family life, but you're just kind of doing it with a, what about me? What about me? Then you're going to be grumpy at people, right? So if you're thinking, what about us? Then me gets taken care of. If you're thinking about me, nothing is ever going to satisfy me because me is an illusion, right? So what about me? You'll think, well, why doesn't anyone ever check on me? Why am I the one that always cooks? Why am I the? And as soon as you get into that thinking, you just start to resent everyone who you really love. Never mind the people who annoy you. The people who you love annoy you, right? So the what about me suffocates your joy. And it's that lie of self-cherishing that creeps in the more tired you get, or if you forget your center, if you forget your motivation. So just keep coming back to that, because that's the main point in joyous effort. Did you have any follow-up stuff about joyous effort before we move on to concentration?
No, it's not about that, but it's just about the what about me and the verse you've just read about loss. Okay, because I think like we have all kind of, there are many things we have lost the last 2 weeks. Everything changed, we can't go places. And many people are not grumpy about it. And many people are not grumpy about it as much as if it would happen only to them, because you don't ask, what about me compared to the other? So it's not about the sin by itself. Okay, and it is how much, it's not about even cherishing the other, it just, when you don't have the comparison, you don't have this hardiness. How do you call it? Like that you have to keep things.
Tight, yeah. Yeah, exactly. If it was just you and your family that had to stay home and everyone else around you got to go out and do whatever they like, it would be so much more grumpy making, right? You'd be so annoyed. But because all of us are in the same position, just the awareness of that makes it less hard. Even though logistically it makes it hard, emotionally or internally it makes it a lot easier because we're all in it together. Just immediately shared suffering lightens the burden, or awareness of shared suffering. I mean, I think, you know, your own wisdom will kick in, I'm sure. But I was thinking a lot about my grandparents went through the Great Depression in the United States. I think everybody had a Great Depression, kind of staggered throughout the world, but the Great Depression when the stock market crashed. And, you know, my grandparents always talked about the Depression. You know, it was a big moment in their life. They talk about the Depression and they talk about the war, right? Those are the things that people in their 80s and 90s talk about, right? The Depression and the war. And what's interesting is that they're happy stories with terrible details, right? They're terrible details. Like, you know, my grandma was talking about how, you know, the game warden would turn the other way and let people hunt out of season, hunt deer and bears and things like that in Montana, even when it was the wrong season for it, because everybody was starving. And kind of the way that neighbors would trade abilities and skills and tools, and how a lot of like law enforcement authority figures would relax and stop being so uptight about a lot of regulations because they just knew they needed to be flexible to get through this terrible time. etc., etc. So, I mean, it was a really hard time for everyone. But the stories they tell are about communities coming together and families coming together. And it doesn't really sound so bad in hindsight, though I'm sure in the moment it was horrible to not know where food was coming from and to really feel like, you know, who knows when this will end. So I think if we can remember that happiness is not dependent on the things that we think it's dependent on, all you need to do is visit a developing country, you know, to visit parts of India and see how joyful poor people can be when they're around other poor people. You know, it's only because we're comparing ourselves to those who have more that we start to feel deprived. You know, like if we had a friend who had suffered polio as a child and had twisted up legs and no money for a wheelchair and just scooted around on a skateboard and had no shoes except for plastic bottles strapped to their feet, it would be like tragic and just unbelievably heartbreaking. But you go to India and you see lots of people who had polio as kids scooting around on their skateboards with no shoes except soda bottles, and they seem fine. I'm sure they wish they didn't have polio, but their joyfulness remains because it's not as stark a contrast to other poor people, or, you know, everybody's got difficulty in their life of a similar type. And so the comparison doesn't put that kind of pressure on us. So it is like right now, we're all in it together. That knowledge lessens the burden. If we were the only one going through this, it would be so much harder. So if you can remind people of that very fact of shared experience makes us more creative and innovative, and it also makes us more connected to each other. I'm not sure about you guys, but I mean, I'm talking to friends online who I haven't talked to in years. We're making a point to talk to each other because we're all isolated. You know, so I'm having these big, long conversations, big heart-to-heart, deep and meaningful conversations online with people I usually see every year or so at a retreat who are good buddies, but we never make a point to have a conversation. Now we're making a point to connect with each other because of this shared hardship. You know, so at the end of the day, I don't know that we'll look back on this as the worst thing ever, even though the details are hard. But, you know, but just see how it sits, how to kind of invite that human wisdom out of people that already knows that. Yeah, what happens if the economy crashes? What happens if our pensions dissolve? What happens if we get sick? We'll look after each other. That's what happens. Yeah, we'll look after each other. And maybe that very fact of looking after each other will be more tangible and more direct than it is when things are easier. We might even be happier, even if we're sick and poor. We might wind up being happier because we are feeling each other's connection more directly. It's possible, right? Yeah, you know, we bring our old habits to a new situation, you know, it's completely human, isn't it? We bring our old habits to a new situation. And so sometimes that's bringing out really lovely, beautiful things in us. And sometimes that's bringing out really kind of animal, self-centered things in us. And if you can just kind of be a bit patient with yourself with a sense of humor and go, look at me hoarding this. I'm sure I could figure out how to use water. Maybe I could get a bidet. I don't know. Other people figure it out. I'll be fine. And you just kind of laugh at yourself, while at the same time saying, it's a little bit nerve-wracking to have to change habits. What if I have to fundamentally change a whole bunch of habits? You know, it can be a bit nerve-wracking. And yet, you know, what's happening in so many places with less traffic is, you know, the pollution is going down and the skies are clearing and the wildlife is coming back. And isn't that what we all wanted anyway? We're all worried about climate change. We're all trying to figure out strategies to minimize consumption. This is kind of forcing us to do the very thing we wanted to do. It's just the transition's going to be a bit awkward, right? The transition's going to be awkward. And if we can just be a bit patient with that, but with that kind of hopefulness of, this could be the very thing that helps us live differently. We all know we need to live differently. And it just like how to do that, you know, and how to get all of us to do it at the same time. This could be the very thing, right? So, you know, so be patient with yourself in freaking out occasionally, because it is a change. But on the other hand, there can be a great deal of hope, because a lot of things need to change. Yeah, back and forth. So, you know, it's these verses of when there's suffering, take it on the path. When there's happiness, take it on the path, right? Everything you can take on the path, everything is enriching. But suffering is compounded when self-cherishing takes ownership. Yeah, so battle it. Yeah, any other bits about joyous effort that you were curious about or just, I don't know, struck a chord in some way?
I feel, Yönten, that if to continue what I said about the monkey mind, that those verses, the joyous effort, invites us to keep our practice, to try to make our mind more steady, more stable, no matter what the outer circumstances are. I mean, if I can choose to give, but if I'm being robbed or someone is stealing from me, immediately I don't want to give. So how can I keep my generosity with joy, although it is not my choice? I didn't choose to give. It has been taken from me. And how in those circumstances, although we are isolated, we can feel compassion and feel connected and feel the interconnectedness to others, although the outer circumstances are very challenging. How can I keep my practice and my mind steady?
I'll tell you when I find out. No.
It's challenging, but those circumstances invite us to examine our mind and how we react, how to make it less reactive to the outer circumstances.
Yeah, exactly. And I think it's difficult when things are stressful to remember how much space of less stress there is in a day, and to use those opportunities to recalibrate. Because what we normally do if we're stressed and then there's a little pocket in the day where there's not as many stressful conditions is we just kind of like are relieved and just kind of go, oh, right? And which is normal and we should for a minute, but then that can kind of get its own habit and you can collapse in a heap even when you don't need to, because that's what you do when there's space in the day. When in fact, those are the times where you can reconnect with your practice to carry you when the stressful conditions escalate again. And so, you know, our morning practice, you know, if you're sort of hardcore, you know, into the bodhicitta stuff, is the first thing you wake up, you revive your bodhisattva vows, which means you've already given everything to everyone. So if they take it, you already gave it. You know, but if you forget that, then it does feel like, hey, that's mine. You know, that's my time you just took, right? And it's like, no, you already gave it. So what's the problem? You know, it's a bit like if you're, I don't know, if I'm like eating something and they just like take it when I'm eating it and they just start to eat it, I'm like, yeah, okay. You know, whereas if one of my friends had done it, I'd be like, excuse me. But because in my mind, it's like we've already offered everything to children anyway, there's not that same kind of like, hey, you know, it's almost like, oh, good, you get a sandwich here, take it. You know that feeling, right? So it's like somehow preemptive strike, like before the day gets momentum to really consciously reconnect with the bodhisattva path. And then when there are those spaces in the day, let yourself collapse in a heap and, you know, relax and be relieved to not have anything to do. But in that same space, use it as an opportunity to come back to center, you know? So you can be, you know, flopped on the couch, you know, with your cup of tea in your pajamas. You don't have to be sitting perfectly in meditation. You know, you can be completely collapsed on the couch and just be like, right, the purpose of my life is, right? And just like get it nice and, you know, imbuing your whole being. And then when you get off the couch, it's going to be better. So it's taking those opportunities where there is space to hold you through when the times when space becomes less, because it will carry you through. It's just, you know, you have to keep coming back enough times. Because if you try to inject your path newly in the middle of stress, it's going to have limited effect. Sometimes it'll stick, and sometimes it's just, it's too much. It's like one more thing, and you're like, I can't think of that right now. I just need to do this. But if you thought about it prior, it could carry in.
I'm just thinking that it's sometimes very hard and tricky to the cycle, because I sit with people I meet and sometimes with myself too, that the hardest time to turn to the other is when you feel deprived from something. And usually where it takes is you feel that you have when you feel bad, you feel that you have nothing to give. And then you need someone to give you to feel that you have something to give. It's a cycle that it's sometimes very hard to break.
Yeah, it is.
So that's the challenge.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. And
from the lower place to do something.
Yep. And, you know, joyous effort is kind of showing how you can refuel yourself. And that refuge and bodhicitta are fuel sources. Other people and interactions with other people and support from other people are really important for beginners like us, are really important conditions for everyone along the path. But they are conditions, they're not the cause, because you could be flooded by support, validation, healthy food, comforts, and not feel it nourishing you if you're in a bad space. You know, just because people love you doesn't mean that you feel it, you know? Just because people are supporting you doesn't mean you notice it, you know? So in order to feel the love that people are giving you, in order to feel the support that people are giving you, it's like you have to be in touch with those aspects that are self-supportive and self-validating first, to create like receptor sites, you know, for all of the help to get to you. And I think it's why so many of our tantric meditations have the refuge object as light, you know, compassionate wisdom here above the crown of the head or in the space in front. We're in a way having an interaction with it. We're describing it to ourselves. We're reminding ourselves that compassionate energy exists. We're reminding ourselves that wisdom energy exists. And then it feeds us, and then we absorb it, and then we send it out. Yeah? So it's like, it exists externally and it becomes interactive, and then it becomes absorbed internally and integrated, and then we send out and help send that to others. And it sounds like just a sweet, relaxing, light process, when in fact there's some really profound ideas underneath it. There's some really profound pieces in just even very simple light in, then out. If you're remembering that it's representing and embodying those values that you cherish, yeah, like love and compassion. Yeah, for us.
Is that applied to the little baby as well? I mean, the idea of if he hasn't the cause to be feeded by, he won't have it. Even to the babies that applied, what you talked about before. Now,
you guys are more experts of babies. I don't have many babies in my life. What do you think?
No. But I mean, you said about that if the person hasn't got the causes to take, he won't take, even if there is a fortune, emotional or financial or nurture. So I'm seeing, is that started at the beginning of life as well? I mean, since the beginning?
Well, I mean, we don't think of babyhood and childhood as the beginning of life, first of all, right? It's just the beginning of this life. So our baby responses are of a similar type to our adult responses. It's just the conditions of us in our body are different. And the way our mind uses our body is different because it's different conditions. So I think it is very much the same, but it's not like that's the start of life. It's a carryover from the habits that came before. Yeah.
You know, I'm asking because we do believe that the matrix that the baby gets to or arrive to determinate his future being. I mean, the empathic matrix, but if thinking in this way, things a bit changing.
I mean, I think that there's something really significant to what you're saying. And I think that premise is a solid premise that seems quite accurate. It's just not the whole story of how we would describe it in the Buddhist worldview, but I think it must be quite true. And your ability to be fed, whether or not the feeding is there or not, and all of that dynamic in the very beginning of this life, you know, it is what kind of cultivates and nurtures the habits from previous lives. You know, I'm sure there's all sorts of interesting ideas about why some babies are able to feed from the breast right away, and some of them have some sort of resistance to it and obstacles to it. I'm sure there's all sorts of interesting psychological ideas about why that might be, or physical ideas about why that might be. But we would say karmically, they already had that disposition. You know, it's not the mother's fault or something like that. It's that there's already something in the dynamic and in the being that means that despite there being resources cannot be taken in. You know, just like the hungry ghosts, right? The hungry ghosts will find food and they will find water, but then it will look like horrible, disgusting things. And even if they try to take it, it burns going in, and they have a tiny little mouth and a giant belly. So even if they find resources, it's never enough and it doesn't sit well. You know, as opposed to people, you know, in the God realm sort of situation where they don't have to put any effort in and resources just are come and are enjoyed. So if we think about this all in the human realm, we see all of these realms within ourselves and within the people we know. There are times when, you know, there's just like a flood of abundance and we can even start to feel entitled to it. Like we deserve it. We work so hard. We're entitled to all of these resources and riches. So we just take and consume and take and consume without even thinking to share or without even thinking of dependent arising. Or we could be flooded with resources and not able to take any of them in because we're in such a deprivation mentality. So there's the conditions and they have an effect, but the main thing is always the mind and always the substantial causes. Yeah, the main thing is always the mind, and we get lost again and again in thinking it's the conditions that are giving or taking happiness. So we know better and we forget, and we know better and we forget. So it's like we have to know better on purpose more and more often. You know, we try to every drink of water, every bite of food, offer it. Yeah, it's a practice that we have because it makes us feel abundant and rich and grateful. And you immediately feel like you've got a feast, you know, so you have a little sip of water in the back of your mind. You're thinking, I'm offering this to all the Buddhas and Bodhisattvas and all sentient beings, because you're really offering yourself. Yeah, the nourishment and health I get from this little glass of water, may it make me a healthy and capable tool to be of benefit to all. So I have to make this, I have to maintain this whole thing. I need to make it really healthy and well. That self-cherishing says, you can get away with not drinking so much water. You can get away with not eating properly. You can get away with not cooking healthy food because you'll be fine. And you will, but you won't be as beneficial to all sentient beings if you're not as healthy as you can be. So it's self-cherishing that lets you off the hook in terms of being healthy and eating well and, you know, exercising enough. You know, self-cherishing says, well, if it's just you and your life, what you're doing is fine. It's enough. You don't need to exercise. You don't need to eat well because you're good enough for yourself if you don't. But if you want to be of benefit to others, you need to be your healthiest. So for their sake, you know, chop some vegetables, go for a walk. You know, it's tricky because it seems indulgent to look after yourself when in fact a bodhisattva looks after themselves very well because they know that it has a ripple effect and they're there to be of benefit to others. They must be healthy. Yeah, and if they're sick, they can take that on the path too, but they're not kind of being martyred. Yeah, they're not being a martyr saying, I'm going to take all this suffering on and I'm just going to be in deprivation mode and just eat one little grain of rice. You know, remember the 12 deeds of the Buddha. He went through that phase and realized it was a bad idea. And then he hit the middle way, right? Yeah. And then he achieved enlightenment.
Like, I read the verses of 12, 13, 14, like you start from you losing your possession to someone tries to cut off your head and then people are humiliating you, etc. And like those practices feels like extreme and like, as you said, like somebody sacrifices himself. But in our very narrow way, we practice it daily. Because we like, that's the way we are in the sessions. We are not, we sit there this way. I mean, you are not about taking for yourself what is robbed. You just see it and you offer it because it is in totally in a different context. So if you talk about it in as a mental practice, we do it in a way. It's just that it's kind of, and also even taking care of yourself. Like you go into a session and you know that you want to be rested before to be able to be the best you can. It's a session. You want to know that you have rested, that you are not hungry, that you can just be there for the session, like for the person that is coming. Okay, that you are not, you'll not be about yourself at that time. And so in a way, those practices, even so they sound really, really extreme, like when you think about it, no, we just have our frame of mind of saying why it is okay. And then we switch to the regular life and say, okay, but now I want more and more money or possessions, et cetera. But it's actually all modes that we already have, that we are already practicing in different ways. And just the borders in between and not getting into a pressure that, yeah, I'll just give everything up and I'll remain robbed afterwards. Because in the session, we have already went into this thing about not being afraid of being robbed of our pride and of our safety and of many things that we are not as guarding.
Yeah, exactly. I think we all have like a certain activity, whether it's a work activity or whatever, where we're organized, right? We're like bodhisattva organized, you know, get enough sleep, eat something properly, drink enough water so that I can be fully present for you, you know? And when you do that, the kind of preparation that you need to do, and you're fully present for you, whoever the you is, aren't you relaxed and energized? You know, and if you haven't done the kind of getting yourself centered thing, you can be relaxed and focused for a bit, but it doesn't have the same sustainability. And there can be the edge of stress, even while you're being very present and very open and very centered. In the background, there can be a little edginess, you know, of I'm here, I'm with you, but I'm sort of looking at the clock, you know, and I'm here and I'm with you, but I'm also sort of looking at the clock. You know, and whereas if you've really, yeah, centered yourself as you described, you know, presence can become effortless in a way because you put a lot of preliminary effort in. Yeah, Raman?
Before we switch to the next perfection, I would like to say something concerning the Hebrew language. In English, it doesn't sound like the same joyous effort, but in Hebrew, the word for effort is etymologically derived from the word courage, ma'amatz, omitz. And I think that when we are in the process of transforming into this psychologically, narcissistically phase of courage, then it doesn't anymore bother us what behavior we don't have, because we are transcending this phase of mine and I. And I think that the language, the Hebrew language, holds this idea very nicely and very profoundly. The ma'amatz, it comes from a courage.
That's interesting because, you know, Pema Chodron, who's, you know, quite the famous author, her commentary to Guide to a Bodhisattva's Way of Life, called No Time to Lose, she uses slightly different translations for the verses and slightly different translations for the perfections. And her translation of joyous effort is heroic perseverance. She uses the word heroic, so maybe more similar to the Hebrew. It's got that sense of courage.
Although the difference between heroic bravery and courage up to quote is very, very distinctive, because the bravery and the heroic person, he's not yet done this transcendental leap from the narcissistic stage to the transformative stage. He made a very, very fine distinction between heroism and courage. Courage is something which is different from heroic. So it's a semantics, of course, but if you are getting into the depths of this semantics, you can figure out what is needed psychologically in order to transform to this kind of efforts.
Yeah, colloquially, we would just combine them and say, if you're heroic, you're courageous. If you're courageous, you're heroic. And we would just equate them as kind of one and the same. So it's interesting to hear about this distinction. Yeah, I'm curious about it. And it is interesting. Translators, I think, sometimes realize how much they are teachers and sometimes they don't. But, you know, so much depends on translation. And this word, you know, joyous effort, was one of the earlier translations of sundri in Tibetan. And there are so many variations. It's really fascinating. Some people translate it as enthusiasm. Some people translate it as just perseverance, not joyous, but just perseverance, which sounds really awful. Some people translate it as energy. Heroic perseverance. There's so many variations, and it's like somehow all of the variations together then give you the sense of what is being said, all of them together. One on its own could maybe miss the mark. And, you know, in Buddhism, you have the word, but then you have to have a whole paragraph to describe what the word means before you can even use the word, because none of them are the same in Tibet, in Buddhism, as they are in the world. But this interesting distinction between courage and heroism, I'm curious about this. What would you say is the main difference? That heroic is more grandiose?
Yeah, exactly. And Cote wrote about it in his paper of 1970, probably. It's not really decided when he wrote it, but it was before he went to Germany, when he was given a very respectful opportunity to talk before the parliament in the university in Frankfurt and so on in Berlin. And he made the distinction between the Nazi regime appeared, between the group of generals who tried at the end of the war to kill Hitler, and he made them as an example of heroes, which are seen, but they are still irrational heroes, what you are calling more grandiose, although they wanted to do something beneficial for the history, possible history, a different history for the Germany and the mankind. And in contrast to this, he took out some simple person, an Austrian peasant, Franz von Jägerstätter. There is a very good film now is going on, Hidden Life, that he very personally refused to take any oath of the Gestapo. And he didn't want to put on the brown uniform that he was forced to. And he was killed, he was executed by the German. And this difference between something that I'm doing, which is, of course, if they had been successful, maybe history would be different for Germany. But it's a very tiny difference that he puts from something that you are doing it exhibitionistically, and something that you are doing from a very deep source. I don't want to be contaminated and to contaminate my loved ones by being cooperating with evil, even by giving my life, sacrificing my life, which wasn't felt as a sacrifice. That's something very, very important in Cohort's distinction.
There's a book by Dilgo Khyentse Rinpoche called Enlightened Courage, that is basically, that's his like description of the Bodhisattva path, is very much like that. And there's something quieter and more humble and also more confident as opposed to proud, it sounds like, in that distinction. Mm-hmm. And I think then it would also be more sustainable as well, whereas maybe the description of heroism would be more kind of a crescendo up, yep, and then a finishing or a completion and then a crashing down, you know, or, you know, because it's egocentric, then there's so much more mental effort of maintenance and needing prestige or whatever that can dampen it down. It's interesting. So when we go into concentration, it starts on page 27, 28, and 29. If you could have a look at those before Monday. This is familiar, but because it's concentration and we talk about that a lot, but the nuance that we're bringing to it is the reasons why. Yeah, the reasons why the concentration. So on page 28 is some review that you'll already know. And then on page 29 at the top, it says how to meditate. First, arouse bodhicitta with the aspiration to establish all beings in the very essence of enlightenment. Then make the seven branch offering and sit properly, adopting the 7-point posture of Varachana. So I want to talk a little bit about this seven branch offering, and there's an asterisk there, and what the seven branches are at the bottom of the page. But we'll talk about that more on Monday. But you'll find it in the Chenrezig meditation that I've given you guys to do today after class. So if you do the Chenrezig compassion meditation, the seven branch offering practice is woven in there. And then we can talk about it in more elaboration on Monday. So we'll just take a minute and let ourselves digest and integrate as best as we can. Thanks, guys. Bye.
Bye, Yönten. Thank you.